mentioning opposition, and I want to start with talking about your own experience from last year during the presidential election in Armenia, which was a very bitterly disputed election. After some street protests, there was clashes on the streets of Yerevan, which left 10 people dead. We used to oppose election violence in Armenia, but not quite to the extent that we had last year. A state of emergency was declared, and the mass media was prohibited from printing anything other than official government press releases. A number of sites were blocked, such as Radio Free Europe. Other sites basically practiced self-censorship. But one thing they didn't touch was blocks. And then suddenly, you know, the blocks filled the information gap, which was very unique for Armenia. They must have had that happen before. The government did not move to actually block these blocks. And so many people think that blocking came of age in Armenia at that time. What was really kind of funny, they did actually block YouTube for a few days, for about a week or something. I can't exactly remember how long. What was very funny about this new media issue is when you have 10 people dead, it doesn't really cause quite a stir as much as blocking YouTube. A friend of mine was in England from Armenia soon after the state of emergency. People didn't approach him and said, my God, they had 10 people died in Armenia. But as soon as YouTube was blocked, everyone was going, my God, they blocked YouTube in Armenia. Wow, what happened? We kind of see things like that. But anyway, what I think though was the problem at the time in Armenia was that we had a very politicized environment, which meant that the blogs were politicized. And one issue that I think some people have mentioned today, and I'm sure will be mentioned again, is that just as blogs can be used for free flow of accurate information, they can also be used for misinformation and propaganda and stirring up problems in society and trying to provoke clashes and so on and so forth from both sides. It was a very hostile environment for both opposition and government. It was impossible for people who were neutral to have their voices heard. And I think this is the problem that Armenia needs to address. So when we talk about blogs, when we talk about the media and the ability for them to empower people, yes, it's true. But one thing that in Caucasus is also very true is not necessarily does everybody have access to these tools. And that needs to be addressed. And I'm sure it needs to be addressed in a lot of other places in the world. Emin, my colleague from Azerbaijan, gave a very interesting and very informative speech earlier, which gave a general overview of the situation in the Caucasus, and especially the issue of low internet penetration. And this, again, goes to this issue of how do you empower these voices. And I think this needs to be an issue that needs to be addressed. I have to be honest, after the politicized nature of the presidential election in Armenia, I became somewhat disillusioned with how extensively blogs were being used for misinformation and disinformation and for creating splits and divisions and so on. But there are some bright spots as well in this. For example, the lesbian and gay community in the Republic of Armenia and also in the Armenian diaspora are using blogs to basically counter extremely homophobic press reports. And you can see how other minorities or other underrepresented voices could also use blogs for that same purpose. What is needed is for someone to basically give them those tools or to introduce those groups, ethnic minorities, environmentalists, religious minorities, you name it, just the masses in general. I think this is an issue that the international community needs to address. And the reason I say that is about a week ago, I was called in by a number of other bloggers to the United States Embassy in Yerevan. Just like when I said there's always hype about YouTube, there's also now hype about blogs. All they know is state of emergency, 20 days, no mass media, blogs. That's the answer to everything. It's only the answer to everything if you have a strategy. And they don't really know what strategy to follow. So everyone thinks, well, give these tools to the media. But I don't personally agree with that, because the mass media has those tools already. This is specific to the Caucasus. The government controls the television stations in countries such as Armenia. The opposition, the print media does allow for diversity and plurality of views, but no one reads the newspapers. And so a lot of the independent or opposition media is online already. They do not need blogs. They already have their online presence. They can already add blogging features to the sites they have. A again, I'm coming back to this issue, something needs to be done to empower the masses, I guess, those people who don't have the tools. It was interesting, though, Sasaki is not here, but he's my colleague from Global Voices, who runs a project called Rising Voices, and that's specifically to address such issues. There was recently an interview with one of the co-founders of Global Voices, who said, when we started doing Global Voices, we suddenly realized that perhaps we should change our name to Elite Global Voices. Because in many cases, all of us around this table have access to those tools. We're not underprivileged. We're not, I don't think so anyway, like having to worry about feeding our children every day. We have computers, we have laptops. Many of us speak English. We're an elite in our society. Especially from regions like the Caucasus. And so basically Global Voices decided to create Rising Voices to address this problem of minority or mass voices who are underrepresented, to give them the ability to speak. I think that's an important issue I'd like people to remember. And also, I know tomorrow some kind of code of ethics is going to be discussed. I personally, after my own personal experience of the presidential election in Armenia, where there was slander, you name it, libel, threats, death threats, misinformation, I really believe a code of ethics is necessary. Obviously, it can't be enforced, it should be voluntary. But those people who do accept and adopt it, perhaps, have a certain amount of credibility, I guess, if they are willing to put their names to it. To the extent that if they break it, they obviously look disgraced, I guess. I personally would like to see this done, but I think it should be voluntary. I think I'd much rather take questions, but just to end, I want to talk about Georgia and Azerbaijan. I'm very, very encouraged and very, very impressed by the lobbying scene in Azerbaijan, even though I don't speak Azeri. I know a number of Azerbaijani bloggers. I've been following a lot of what Emin presents at different conferences and workshops. Because of internet penetration, which is much higher in Azerbaijan, there's much more of a potential, I think, in that country than, say, Armenia. But also, I think it's more than just access. I think it's also the types of people that are using it. I've really been impressed by a lot of the blogs. I've been privileged to know a lot of the bloggers who are actually blogging. I wish them every success with that. I think Georgia, I was recently in Georgia and for a new media forum, and I also think Georgia would be a country to watch. And I think that Georgia may also evolve in its own way as well, because the three Caucasian countries are kind of, how to say, Georgia is considered to be the most democratic, Azerbaijan is considered to be the less democratic, Armenia is somewhere in between with a tendency towards authoritarianism, so perhaps closer to Azerbaijan and Georgia. As a result, the media is freer in Georgia, and as a result, I think there's more potential for civil society, in particular NGOs, to start using new media, social media tools, in order to create more information that perhaps journalists can use as sources. I'm a journalist as well, and of late, I've been really reliant on, for example, blogs in Azerbaijan, blogs in Georgia, in order to report. It's given me a new source of information, as long, of course, as you can consider the sources to be trusted. So I think we need to look at the whole range of options, empowering people. What constitutes a blogger? This was also discussed earlier by the guy from the tweeting company, and it's something I also discussed last night with some people in the restaurant. What is a blogger? Well, should we be using this term anyway? Because of Facebook, because of Twitter. Many people use Facebook as their own blogs, but they wouldn't call themselves bloggers. But what they're effectively doing is blogging. I also am now more and more using Twitter, more and more following on Twitter. That's my group.